your moves. When you are playing, for example, some kind of game, right? What your moves are, what your tactics are, you don't tell the opponent. But Allah is so confident that He's answered these questions in the Quran so well that even the doubts of the Quraysh are mentioned in the Quran. Because Allah knows that Quran can answer those things. So one of the doubts was that how can we be given life after we become part of the earth? Now, rather they are in matter of the meeting with their Lord, disbelievers. But Allah says no. Perhaps it's not that they are doubting this thing. What they don't want is they want to just enjoy in this world. And after that, they think that that's the end of it. They don't want to meet their Lord thereafter, right? They are deniers. Say the angel of death will take you who has entrusted you with you. Then to your Lord, you will be returned. So this is just a translation, simple translation of those verses. Let's look at this. So we discussed yesterday in detail verses 5 and 6. Now we go into ayat number 7, as we said, right? That Allah has created everything perfect. You know? This is now Allah Ta'ala says, an example taken from Al-Mizan. It says, when we ponder how things have been created, we see that each one's parts are in harmony with one another, and that each one has a whole, is fully equipped with whatever is conducive to its perfection and felicity, in such a way that there is no way it could be better equipped for its purpose. Subhanallah. Allah Ta'ala is saying that, if you see the eyes, the way they've been created, if you see the ears, if you see the mouth, if you see the hands, right, all these things, there are so much, there is perfection and harmony that you could not have been something better than that. Now, this is the trust He's putting in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, if you see even today, I remember one day I had a friend who said that, we don't realize this hand. You can see these five fingers, how they move, what are the sizes, all these things have a lot of role to play. And he said that, the only people who realize the value of these hands and their proportionment is that when they, for example, somebody gets an accident, God forbid, and now the plastic surgeon or the doctor has to now recreate those hands and the function of the fingers. They said they put so much effort in trying to recreate this thing. God forbid if somebody's hands, for example, is crushed or some kind of accident, and now you go to doctor and they try to now recreate these things. There is so much effort put into it, you only realize when you start recreating. But because we are born with these things, we take it for granted. So you can see, Allah says that you can see that such a way that there is no way it could be better equipped for its purpose, other than this, right? He said, nothing that exists is considered evil insofar as existence. No, insofar as it exists and is created entity. And then he says, because it is created from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again in his trust, he says, nothing is created which is evil. No, it is not at all, he says. This is indicated by the verse, because Allah says, Allah said already that He has created everything perfect, right? He says, as you can see earlier, Alladhi ahsana kulla shayin khalaqahu. Ahsana is not, hasan is good, but ahsan is superlative degree. So Allah has created in the best way, the most perfect way in whatever He's created. And then He says, along with that, if you put another ayat, Allah says, Allahu khaliqu kulli shay'in. So every creation is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everything what He creates is perfect. If you put these two things together, He said that nothing that exists is considered evil insofar as it exists and is created entity. This is indicated by these two verses. Then He says, from these two verses, we deduce, firstly, creation, that means hulka, the creation entails perfection. It is, there is husna, there is asana khalaqa kulli shay'in. There is that perfection in creation, right? And that every created thing is good insofar as it is created thing. As long as it is created by Allah, it is in good. And this is, if we believe in this thing, then we would not question. Sometimes, for example, people even question that, why was I, created like this? Why was I created an Indian? Why was I created Iranian? Why was, Allah has created, there is wisdom, Let us appreciate it, that this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And He says, number two, right? And then He says after that, secondly, that all evil and badness is not something created insofar as it's evil or bad. Such as sin and evil deeds insofar as all things are only evil relative to one another, not in its absolute sense. So evil is evil not in absolute sense, it is relative to other things. And of course, he gets into a big philosophy discussion in Al-Mizan, subhanAllah. He does tafsir, then there's a discourse. Discourse, that means a long discussion, no philosophical discussion about the creation of evil, which is not our discussion just now because I feel that it will be above our standard just now, and especially we will not be able to complete the surah as we plan. And he says, now Allah says, and commence man's creation from clay, right? Here man refers to species as a whole. The creation was from clay as they descended from those who were created from clay, namely Adam and Eve. So when Allah says that he created us from clay, he's referring to Adam and Hawa, that they were created from clay. But after that, you and me, we continue through procreation. So this is Allah Ta'ala Batai, is, you know, volume 32, page 54. This was just a little brief discussion about creation. Now we go to the next verse, right? This verse points to the creation of man's progeny, because now you can see, after Allah says that he has created khalaqu min teen, he says, summa ja'ala naslahu min sulalatin min ma'in mahin. And then, of course, after that, he created his nasal, that means his progeny, from a water which is base, mahin, right? Semen, money, which we say, right? So Allah says, after that, the creation is from that, right? So then, he says that now, of course, this verse now points to the creation of men's progeny and how children of Adam are born in later stages. The Arabic word ja'ala here means creation. And the term nasal indicates to the progeny and grandchildren all stages, right, as we go. Verse number 9, he says, one of the signs of man's honor is the divinity spirit, divine spirit, which has been breathed into him. Now, subhanAllah, Allah also says in Quran, وَلَكَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ, right? We have actually honored Banu Adam. You know, human being has that special kind of dignity. We forget sometimes. Imagine this is what Quran says. Every human being. Sometimes we even look down upon about our own spouses. If you have, a disagreement, suddenly we try to say such words against our own spouse. You know, we forget all the akhlaqiyat. And that person is your spouse, mother of your child, or the father of your child. And Quran says, no. Human being itself has a dignity. Why? Because the ruh which is there in us, this is the divine, right? So you can see, he says that, you know, in this verse, there are some hints to the complicated science of man's development, right? But they said, man's honor is the divine spirit which has been breathed into him. And then, of course, there are complicated stages of man's development in the environment of womb, as well as stages that Adam passed at the time when he was created from clay. Then, of course, he says, Allah says, then he fashioned him and breathed into him his spirit, and appointed for you your hearing, sight, and hearts. But little is that you give thanks. SubhanAllah, Allah knows very well, this human being will never be grateful, right? But before I go further, let me just share with you that poetry of Hafiz. No? Just one line, although I don't read Farsi like this, but I remember this poetry long ago. You can see Allah says that we were created from the clay, and then the procreation continued from a water which was base, referring to money, the semen, right? So this is the origin of human being. So Hafiz says in Farsi, man man chimi kuni ke tu askatra ye mani. He says, oh human being, why is so much ego and pride in you? Don't you see your origin? What is the origin? Your origin is semen, money, right? A najis thing is the origin. Where does this pride come from? You know, you can see sometimes just because you've got some kind of ability, some handsomeness, some beauty, some money, some qualification, suddenly brings about that kind of pride. So Hafiz, who is a great poet, you ask Iranians, they'll tell you how great that person is. Full of, he says, what is this I, man man chimi kuni, that I am somebody. Tu as katra e mani, your origin is not just, you know, a drop of money, right? So that's why he says that this is all stages of creation, right? That Allah fashioned him, breathed into him his own spirit, right? The Arabic term sawa, fashion him, is derived from the taswiya, in the sense of to complete, and this refers to the whole stages. The fact that you can see Allah says he did not even create us. He created us, but then he completed us. That means he fashioned us and perfected the creation. Another thing I can again draw your attention to, because we are discussing this thing. This is the beauty, right? When you give lecture, this is, I feel sometimes like ilham, like inspiration, that Allah is making you, you know, remember those great things. We say in Gujarati, Khuda Sujavej, you know, positive things, right? That there is a book, and you should read this thing, especially in month of Ramadan, if you would like to do something good, known as, no, what philosophy, Tawheed Mufaddal. Tawheed Mufaddal. It is available online. You can also get a copy at the bookstore. This was by the sixth Imam. Mufaddal was one of the companions of Imam. He once came with questions of Imam, right? And Imam realized that his question was in depth, although Imam does not need time to think. But the person, Imam realized that Mufaddal himself will not be able to take the answer just at a go. So Imam said, just prepare yourself, come tomorrow and bring your notes, everything. I'm going to dictate to you the philosophy, the wisdom of human creation, that you see the eyes, why there is tears, why the eyes are here, why there is a forehead here, why the ears are here, why there is only one nose. All those details, in detail, subhanAllah, you'll be amazed. It's amazing to see that Imam Sadiq al-Islam, during those ages, when the medicine had not advanced, when we did not have all these kind of cameras, everything, at that time he could describe all this creation in detail and the wisdom behind it. So you can see Allah says, فَسَوَّاهُ, that means he did not only created, but he perfected the creation. This is the beauty of it, Mumineen. When we realize this thing, you know, human being is so ungrateful that sometimes, for example, we have such a good health throughout our life, suddenly when somebody gets sick, we complain so much. We forget about, you know, that all this time we were healthy, Allah created. Now that we are sick, and maybe the sickness is also its own reasons. Sometimes we are our own care, we are responsible. For example, if I did not take my food well, if I did not rest well, if I overate, could be those are the reasons, right? But we complain so quickly. So he says that no, Sawa fashion his tasweeb to complete, and this refers to the whole stages that a person passes from the time of being in the form of semen as far as the stage when all the limbs of his body appear. All those stages, right? The development of semen in the womb reaches a stage that it starts moving and other faculties gradually appear in it. They start developing, right? This stage is the same as the stage that the Quran renders into breathing the spirit, right? You can see that now a worthy spirit which is eligible to be called Allah's spirit, Ruh of Allah, was breathed into a human being. You can imagine. So do you see the status of human being? That is the breath of Allah. This indicates that through man, from the point of material dimension, is made of darkness, though the man is made of darkness or from a worthless water, but from the spiritual point of view, it carries spirit of Allah. Do you see this thing? Although the origin is money, right? But when, although that was the origin of it, but after that, when the ruh is the breath, that is a divine thing. And that is why it makes human being a dignified person. And this applies to everyone. Mumineen, yeah, sometimes we have, for example, non-Muslims, we have Christians, Jews, they have their beliefs, their belief system. But that does not at all mean that you would not respect. For example, if you see in a bus, right, a senior has come, and you are young sitting there, right? Don't say, oh, this is a kafir. I don't need to give him a seat. This is against Islamic spirits. Believe me. You are young. This person is a senior. Doesn't matter whether he's a Muslim, non-Muslim, a Christian. Maybe you know he's a Buddha, he's an atheist. That doesn't matter. He is a human being. She is a human being. Stand up. Just rise and give that seat to that person. This is what Islamic teachings are. We are forgetting completely. No? Suddenly we think that, no. I'm a Muslim. How can I give my seat to him? Who says so that? You know? So you can see that here, although the origin of human being is a spirit, money, but then the rule is makes it divine, right? In the stage of creation, which is counted its fifth stage, right? The Quran has pointed to the bounties of ear, eye, and heart, right? The meaning here is not the creation of these limbs, because this creation happens before breathing spirit, right? But the purpose is a good hearing, a good sight, and a good perspicuity and wisdom, right? That this brings about a good sight, a good, you know, at the end of the day, when we use our heart well, there is wisdom. But then, subhanAllah, unfortunately, human being, and let us pray that we are not amongst them. Human being is that what Allah says, Kalilam ma tashkurun. How little is that we are grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mumin at every stage, try to find opportunity, try to find excuses to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no way we can thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enough, right? But we should do that at every stage. You decided to come to Husseinia today, right? You reached here safely. I don't know how many of us, including myself, when we reached here, did we say, Alhamdulillah, Ya Allah, I reached my destination safely. We just take it for granted. Not only that, in fact, sometimes there are certain things we take it for so much granted that we don't even thank for that. I always give this example, right? Since our childhood, as we were born and we started now getting up and sitting and walking, our ability to rise and sit, right? We think this is obvious. This is something which is there. What is there to think about? But go to the hospital. Go to a hospital and see a person who is bedridden. Now he or she has to go to the washroom. Look at the efforts which that old person is taking in just getting up from the bed. With all the efforts, sometimes nurse, sometimes, for example, stick, everything, then cause worship, right? All these things. We don't realize. But we are reminded this thing every day in namaz, but we are forgetting. What do we say? Bihawlillahi wa quwwatihi akumu wa aq'ud. With the power and strength given to me by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I rise and I sit. And no, Ayatullah Hui Marhum and Ayatullah Asistan also, they say that in namaz there are four states. In namaz, we stand, which is known as Qiyam, we go to Ruku, right? We go to Sajda, and then we sit. There are four states. Qiyam, Ruku, Sajda, and Qu'ud. So Ayatullah Asistan says, how good it would be that you complete by saying, Bihawlillahi wa quwwatihi akumu وَأَقْوُدْ وَأَرْكَعُ وَأَسْجُدْ. With the strength and power given to me by Allah, I rise, I go to, no, I sit, no, I go to ruku, I go to sajda, take all those four stages, right? بِحَوْلِ اللَّهِ وَأَقْوُدْ أَكُومُ وَأَقْوُدْ وَأَرْكَعُ وَأَسْجُدْ, right? So also try to do this, very easy. أَرْكَعُ, that means I do ruku, أَسْجُدْ, that means I do sajda, right? Just add those two phrases and you complete thanking Allah. But what is the point here? Is that we are reminded that even that rising, going to ruku and sajda and sitting and sit and standing, this is happening with the strength and power given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not just natural, but we tend to forget. And that's why Allah says, Kalilam ma tashkurun. How little is that you are thankful. And that is, let us pray to Allah that as in the month of Ramadan, this is our second fast, we are in the state of fasting, and the Prophet says that if we pray in the state of fasting, our du'as are accepted, that we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we should not amongst those who are ungrateful. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. We go to the next verse, ayat number 10, right? Examples that state the ungratefulness of men, that after seeing all the providence and power of the Almighty, yet men doubts the establishment of hereafter. So one of the ungratefulness of human being is that who has seen the hereafter, right? We have not seen it. Nobody has gone and come back. So why should we believe in it? This is already ungratefulness. Because Allah has told us, the Prophet has told us, Imams have told us, the great scholars have told us, the awliya of Allah, the friends of Allah have told us. Literature is filled with that. And as I said earlier, that Quran actually logically, with wisdom, explains that there is life after death, right? But even then we question. The sentence, we are lost in the earth, refers to this fact that after his death, man will become dust, like other kinds of dust. And as the result of natural factors and non-natural ones, every particle of it will be thrown into a corner, and it seems that there remains nothing of him until when he will be returned into hereafter. So human being just says that, okay, I went to bury my relative, my father, grandfather, he was buried, is gone. You know, how can there be life after death, right? SubhanAllah. But in fact, right? They do not deny the power of Allah in discretion, but they deny that meeting the Lord. So this is it, you know? What commentators are telling us, in reality, these people, they believe in Allah. All of us believe in Allah. We know that Allah is powerful, right? But what is it? People don't like responsibilities, right? If I say there is life after death, then what happens? That means I'm responsible of what I'm doing in this world, right? Now that is difficult. That is difficult because that means everything I do, everything I spend, everything I say, you know, we are told, subhanAllah, on the day of judgment, we are told, some scholars tell us that we'll be given volumes of books, huge volumes of books. Said, take this. So you'll say, what is this? He said, this is, you are the author of this. He said, subhanAllah, what are you talking? I did not even author 5 pages of article. You are telling me all these books. He said, this contains of everything you have been just chatting and talking. This is now written, you can see. This is recorded now. This, everything is there, right? So we don't realize what we are doing. So because he is denying that responsibility, you know, of meeting Allah, that is why he, in fact, does not want to believe in the hereafter. Otherwise, Allah has the ability to that. They want to reject the stage of meeting their Lord, which is the stage of divine reckoning and giving reward and distribution in order that consequently they become free to do whatever they want to do here, right? In this world, they want to become free. And because of that, they have the concept of just forgetting hereafter. Remember yesterday I was telling you that we were discussing about, you know, creation of heavens and earth, that look at just now, there is a lot of discussion about the environment, right? But throughout that environment discussion, that what's happening, there is no mention of word. I said, if a weatherman were to say that tomorrow, if God wishes, we'll have snowfall. If he has to just say, if God wishes, he will just lose his job, right? He'll be fired. Because they don't want God at all in all this thing, right? So you can see this is that they want to just enjoy their life in this world and don't want to be responsible. So we look at, for example, some verses which is telling us the ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Qiyamah, which is Surah number 75 of the Quran, just 3 verses, right? Bismillah ar-Rahman. أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَلَّنْ نَجْمَعُ وَالْإِزَامَ. Does human being think that we are not going to assemble the bones? Not only, remember I was telling you that a doctor has to recreate the hands, is such a huge thing. So Allah says, do you think that we cannot again assemble these bones? No. Bala, kadrina, an nusaviya banana. Not only that, we can put together in perfect order the very tips of his fingers. You know, in olden days, we don't hear about this. In olden days, remember when we used to, for example, sign something, we would be told, just put your thumb, because this mark on my thumb differs with his mark, and his mark, everybody, right? Although all of us are Khojas and Indians and same origin, but even my brother's mark will be different. Allah says that Allah has the ability to recreate this even thumb mark, right? He says, this is known as banana in Arabic. No? So he says, Bala qadrina, we have the kudrat, an nusaviya banana, bal yuridul insanu liyufjira amama. But rather, human being is just what? He just, you know, wants to wish to do wrong even in the time of in front of him. That whatever just now he just wants to do about that, what is that? Yus'alu ayyana yawm al-qiyamah. And then he's asking question, when would the day of judgment come? It's not possible. This is not possible, right? This is what they are denying, the reality. And that's where they come. And this is ungratefulness of human being. Again, Angapuya in his Tafsir, mentioning the Prophet, he says, man has been created to live forever, not to vanish into nothingness. He is transported from one place where he acts as he chooses to the place where he shall live forever, happy or miserable, according to the deeds and he has chosen to do. So you can imagine, Mu'mineen, when the death comes, right, it is just transformation from one stage to another stage. Again, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah give us the ability to realize these realities taught by the Quran and the Prophet. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Next ayat 11, right? Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman, Kul yatawafakumul malakul mawti alladhi wukkila bikum summa ila rabbikum turja'un. O Prophet, just tell them, those who deny about this thing, that Allah is the one, the angel of death will take you, who has been entrusted with you, right? The one who has been entrusted with engage with this work, they'll come and take you. You know, وَكِلَ بِكُمْ ثُمَّ عَلَى رَبِّكُمْ تُرْجَعُونَ, and then your return will be to your Lord. So keep in mind that the angel of death will come. We cannot deny that. We cannot run away from that, no. Regarding the concept of Quranic phrase, يَتَوَفَّاكُمْ, right, which is derived from tawaffa, right, in the sense to take back, right, it is. Death does not mean annihilation, subhanAllah, and destruction, but it's just kind of taking man's soul by angels, the soul forms the most essential part of human existence, right? It is true that Quran speaks about the resurrection of the body and counts the return of material body and soul receives in resurrection. But the aim of the above mentioned verse is to state this fact that the basis of man's personality is not formed from these material limbs, right, which we have occupied our thought, but it is that very worthy spirit, right, that ruh, which has come from outside of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That makes me, right, always, for example, say that I am talking, right, I am doing this thing, I am standing, but just now if my ruh were to leave me, then I will not be there. Where will the eye appear? My limbs will still be there. I'm still there with all the limbs, but the ruh just leaves me. So you can see, what is this eye? Eye is not my hands. Eye is not my eyes. Eye are not my feet. Eye is that ruh that Allah has made, right? So this is taken, right? And of course, in another place, Allah says, not only that angel, sometimes he says, even Allah takes. So all these things, that means Allah, even if the angel comes in the order of Allah's mouth. So Allah says another ayah, for example, and this is a beautiful ayah. This ayat, actually, we should read every day to realize what we go through. No? Allah says, Bismillah, Allahu yatawaffal anfusu hina mawtiya wallati lam tamut fi manamiha fa yumsiku allati qada alayhi al-mawta wa yursil ukhra ila ajal musamma inna fi thalika al-ayatin li kawmi yatafakkaroon. Subhanallah. Allah says that Allah takes the souls at the time of their death, right? And at those who do not die, He takes during their sleep, right? So you can see that when a person goes, every time, the hadith says, sleep is the sister of death. Every time I sleep, actually, I'm going towards death. You don't realize. If Allah decides, I can sleep and I will not wake up. But then, of course, says He keeps those for which He has decreed death and releases the others for specified term. Indeed, in that are the signs for people who are, you know, who give thought. So in other words, that when I go to sleep, actually, I'm going towards death. If Allah has decided that I will die tonight, that's it, right? Otherwise, He will just give me time and I'll come back again. So you can see every death, actually, every sleep is a death. And when we wake up again, we should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And this is what every time as we wake up, we should thank Allah that He has given us life again and return it back to Him. And may Allah give us the faith that as we wake up with a good day, confirming good deeds. And then, of course, the next ayah, subhanAllah. وَلَوْ تَرَىٰ إِذِ الْمُجْرِمُونَ نَاكِسُوا رُؤُوسِهِمْ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ رَبَّنَا أَبْصَرْنَا وَسَمْعِنَا فَرَجِعْنَا نَعْمَلْ صَالِحًا إِنَّا مُوقِنُونَ. SubhanAllah, we'll end today's discussion with this ayah. It's a beautiful ayah. Because human being often, we always want to do good. But when? Not today. Not tomorrow. Pachiti, George. I remember one day I was in Nairobi many years ago. Sometimes I share with my personal stories because, you know, these are learning things, right? I was there very young. This was my first job after my university. My first job was I was asked to sell Islamic books in the city of Nairobi. Those who know Nairobi, downtown, Stanley Hotel. Just down there was a small kiosk there. We used to sell Islamic books. In those days, we had very few books, right? One gentleman came, an elderly person. He must be in his late 60s. He came to me and said, "Tame bo saru kam karo chu. A bo saras kam che. Inshallah, hu palek dis akaris." I was young at that time in my 20s. I said, "Subhanallah, I'm in my 20s, and you are in your 60s, and you're saying, 'Hu pan akaris, kya re karis? When are you going to do this good deed? No? Why not now? Why?" So you can see that you say, "Walaw tara izal mujrimuna naqisu rusihim inda rabbihim." Now that after death, the arrogant people, the guilty, disbelievers in the deniers of the hereafter will entail their shame in the hereafter, because that is the day of manifestation of realities. When they see the realities, right? It is the time when the eyes and the ears will work properly, right? Because now they'll see. When they see these sense, senses of the hereafter, they will come to some realization. But this awareness is temporary again. Quran is telling us the same people, even on the day of judgment, after seeing the reality, they wish that they did not do something wrong. They wish that they are given time to go and do back. But no. In fact, Quran is telling us, وَلَوْ رُدُّوا لَعَادُوا لِمَا نُهُوا عَنْهُ وَإِنَّهُمْ لَكَاذِبُونَ. Allah says, indeed, if they were to be sent back to the world, they would commit the same which they were forbidden to. Undoubtedly, they are liars. I know you'll excuse me, but in Gujarati, there is a saying. They say, Vandro kadi tekra na bule. Right? A monkey will always be jumping here and there, right? You can see a person who has the habit of doing wrong, he will continue doing it because he has not done realization. So even after he dies and sees the hereafter and knows the reality that this is what is I'm going to face, even then, if he was given life, he'll go back. Right? But subhanAllah, you can see the most important thing is, he says, Rabbana absirna wasa'ayna, right? Oh Allah, now we have seen the reality and we can hear all these things. Farji'na na'mal salian inna mukinun. They say to Allah, Ya Allah, please send us back to the world. Na'mal salian, we are going to do good deeds. Inna mukinun, and we are certain about that. Right? The thing is, you can see even the guilty ones, even those who denied about the hereafter, who denied about resurrection, who denied about the day of judgment, even they are saying that, Ya Allah, if you send us back to the world, what we are going to do? Na'mal salian. We are going to do good deeds. My question is, why don't we do it today? Why not now? Why till later on? Why we want to wait? If you want to do something good, do it now, do it today. Not even tomorrow, not even later. That should be the case. Let us live in the world of now, especially when it comes to good deeds, right? But you can see that even they want to go back to perform good deeds. No, no. We have been given this life. And as the example, subhanAllah, we are told, that there is no way that we can go there, right? And say that, no, the guilty would like return to do good deeds. But it says, let us invest our time, right? This is important. As you say that it is any case, the return to this world is impossible. The way return of a child to mother's womb is impossible. How can a child, after being born and grown, can go to the womb of mother? Or for example, how can a pick fruit go to the tree again? In the same way, there is no going back to the life, right? This is the life Allah has given us. And we are so fortunate, Mumineen, that we are going through the month of Ramadan, which is the best season, the best time, the best moment to perform good deeds. Because we are told every wajibat gets the reward of 70 times. And every mustahab gets the reward of 2,000 times. So let us try to make our best to do good things. And of course, of all the good things, let us try to read the Quran, understand the Quran, reflect the Quran, and try to follow in the Quran as it was taught and practiced by the Prophet in his Ahl Bayt. Wa salli ala Muhammad wa alihi tahirin. Rahimullahu man kara al-Fatiha. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahmanir rahim. Maliki yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين